Good morning, and thank you very much for joining us. Within Washington parameters is an early time of the morning. In the real world, it's not, but in terms of our traffic. We're delighted that you could come today for a common word between us and you, a global agenda for change. Our conference is co-sponsored by Georgetown University's Office of the President, the Prince Al-Walid bin Talal Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding, and the Royal Al-Bayt Institute of Islamic Thought of Jordan. But our first question ought to be, why are we here and what's unique about this? Is this just another major event, conference, people come together, they talk, they agree, they disagree, they work at agreeing by the time the meeting's over, and then we just go back to what we're doing. The conference you will be seeing today is based on a groundbreaking initiative and subsequent conferences at Yale and Cambridge universities that dealt with the theological and biblical implications of the two great commandments, and indeed the common word that Muslims, Christians, and Jews share in common, love of God and love of neighbor. Today, however, in contrast to the earlier conferences upon which we build, we now turn to a global agenda for change, designed to be unique in many ways, in particular in terms of the orientation and organization of the program, and in terms of what we want to see ourselves getting out of this program. We will address the so what factor. How do we respond to and put love of neighbor into action? Indeed, what are the implications? You know, who is the neighbor? Is the neighbor just a member of our own religious community or the global community? Well, in many ways, a common word affirms that we're talking about the global community. And indeed, at Yale and Cambridge, this theme was brought out. But what does that really mean? How do we translate it? Other than, again, simply that we agree on some things. How do we transform, in the words of some of my colleagues, a common word into common works? How do we turn dialogue into action? What can and should we do? Today, you're going to hear about the good practices that already exist. But we're also going to seek to develop an agenda for change, identifying areas and projects we want to pursue and develop in the future. To maximize on the input, advice, and expertise of our global leaders. And remember, our global leaders here are prominent religious leaders, academic experts, but also leaders of major NGOs and organizations. But to maximize on their input, we have to make them very uncomfortable. As I've said before in another talk that I gave, all the speakers will be expected to be very, 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 and I'd add another very, for some, brief. Our moderators are asked to be aggressive. I want to emphasize that, to be aggressive in their timekeeping and in promoting a conversation among our panelists and with our participants, with our audience. In order to do that, people are not being asked to read papers, but rather to put out a few ideas to begin an engagement in a conversation. Now, I will be a shining example to all of staying within the allotted time and move quickly to introducing Georgetown's president, John J. DeGioia. Dr. DeGioia is the 48th president of Georgetown University. Under his leadership, the university completed a $1 billion capital campaign, launched the largest expansion of campus facilities in the institution's history, one of which blocks the vision from my office, but I don't want to get into that, or at least it partially blocks it. Significantly, and this is important, increased our student financial aid and strengthened endowments for faculty research. His presidency has been marked by a significant deepening of Georgetown's engagement with the global community, supporting initiatives ranging from interreligious dialogue to global health. In particular, he has consistently demonstrated his strong commitment to interreligious and intercivilizational dialogue and action. During his presidency, He has been supportive of established centers such as my own, the Jewish Civilization Program, but also initiated a new center, the Berkeley Center, and has been supportive of the expansion of the theology department, a development of a doctoral program, and of Arabic studies becoming a department of Arabic and Islamic studies. Dr. DeJoy is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, chair of the Board of Campus Compact, a board member of the Forum for the Future of Higher Education, and in 2008, he was honored by Washingtonian Magazine as a Washingtonian of the Year. Welcome.
Thanks, John. What a great day. Thank you very much, John, for that kind introduction. And again, thank you for all the extraordinary work that you've been engaged in as co-host of this conference. You and our other co-host, His Royal Highness Prince Ghazi bin Mohammed bin Talal of Jordan, have provided a great service through your leadership. This gathering could not have happened without your vision and your service, and we're all in your debt. Well, it's a pleasure to again welcome all of you to Gaston Hall and to the second day of a common word between us and you, a global agenda for change. We're grateful to our distinguished panelists for joining us today, and I know that their discussion on religious pluralism in the 21st century will prove to be informative and insightful. As I noted at yesterday's opening forum, we live at a time when nations are increasingly interconnected, people more interdependent, and humanity less divided by narrow domestic walls. We also live in a global community too often mired in conflict, with interactions between faiths too often characterized by mistrust. In such a world, we deny or fear others whose beliefs or faiths or religions are different than our own, at our own peril. We must overcome the distrust and fear that we may feel when we encounter those who are different than ourselves, those who may not share our culture, our faith, our ideas, and ideals. But it's not simply a matter of doing this to avoid conflict. When a society, when a global community embraces everyone in its midst, it becomes stronger. Distrust and fear, whether between individuals or groups, too often stems from a lack of engagement, a lack of interaction, a lack of understanding. And that's why it's imperative that above all we reach out, that we engage those whose faiths and cultures are different than our own. And that's why events such as this conference are so important, particularly as they seek to find ways to bring the Islamic and Christian communities closer together and to help build bridges of understanding. Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, one of the founders of the Hasidic movement in Judaism, wrote in the 19th century that there is a narrow bridge between connection and identity, which we all must walk. We must walk the bridge with care, yet without fear, and we must work for connection. And that is the purpose and the guiding principle of our gathering here this week. And to present the purpose of our conference in a deeper context, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ibrahim Kalin. Dr. Kalin is the chief advisor to the Prime Minister of Turkey and is currently on leave from Georgetown, where he serves as assistant professor in our School of Foreign Service as part of the Prince Awalid bin Talal Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding. He's a broadly trained scholar of Islamic studies and has published widely on Islamic philosophy and relations between Islam and the West. One of his works, Islam and the West, won the 2007 Writers Association of Turkey Award for Best Book. We're grateful to have him with us today, and it's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ibrahim Kalin.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to begin by thanking Dr. DeJoya for his visionary leadership for bringing, among many other major initiatives, the Common Word Conference and Initiative to Georgetown. Throughout this whole process, when we began working on the Common Word Conference before, and has been involved actually longer than just during this conference. He's provided remarkable leadership and model for all of us. And I want to thank Dr. Esposito, my director, my colleague at the Center for Muslim Christian Understanding, for his continuous encouragement and leadership in bringing the common word, in fact, to full fruition, because he was one of the first to launch the common word here in the United States with Dr. Nasser 2 years ago in 2007. And ever since then, the common word has flourished into a major international interfaith initiative between Muslims and Christians, and not only in terms of organizing the conference, but also providing substance, content, thoughts, ideas. Dr. Esposito has been part and parcel of this initiative, and of course, I mean, his scholarly record, it's very well known to everyone, and I've been very pleased and privileged, actually, to work with him on this and many other projects together. Finally, I want to thank His Royal Highness Prince Ghazi, who unfortunately was not able to join us today, but he has been, as those who have been involved with the Common Word Initiative know, he has been the driving force behind this. He was the first to author the Common Word document itself, and in terms of organizing, mobilizing, encouraging all of us, the scholarship in the Muslim world, the scholars, the major scholars, the Grand Muftis of Egypt, of Bosnia, of Turkey, Jordan, and many other signatories who made the Common Word possible. He's been really single-handedly put in motion something really remarkable and historical, and the results of it are seen here, but they've been seen in other places also. I want to read parts of his paper that he's presented to this conference, and he asked me on his behalf to make a summary of it here, so I'll just read parts of it. It's a summary of what the Common Word has achieved so far and some of the main themes that have been emphasized throughout the meetings that we have had before. So I will just go to his paper, and which will give you an idea about how the Common Word started and what it has achieved over the last 2 years. The Common Word between us and you is an interfaith theological document initially released on October 13, 2007, as an open letter signed by 138 leading Muslim scholars and intellectuals. It was addressed to the leaders of the Christian churches and denominations of the entire world, starting with His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI. In essence, the open letter proposed, based on verses from the Holy Quran and the Bible, that Islam and Christianity share at their core the twin golden commandments of the paramount importance of loving God and loving one's neighbor. Based on this joint common ground, it called for peace and harmony between Christians and Muslims around the world. A common word between us and you follow up and expanded upon a shorter open letter that was released exactly a year earlier by a core group of 38 leading Muslim scholars, addressed solely to His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI, 1 month after his Regensburg lecture of September 13, 2006, calling for better dialogue between Muslims and Christians. The first letter had met with little reception beyond a polite acknowledgement. Thus, the second letter sought to broaden and globalize the conversation between Christians and Muslim religious leaders, and giving it a specific theological platform and focus. In the first year after its release, a common word open letter met a reception that can only be properly described by the grace of God as historical. Within that year, it became the world's leading interfaith dialogue initiative between Christians and Muslims specifically. It was unprecedented in its importance, scope, and global traction. Around 70 leading Christian figures have responded to it in one form or another, including His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI, the late Russian Orthodox Patriarch Alexei II of Russia, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. Rowan Williams, Presiding Bishop of the Lutheran World Federation, Bishop Mark Hansen, who is with us here today, the President and General Secretary of the World Alliance of Reformed Churches, the President of the World Baptist Alliance, Reverend Dr. Samuel Kobia, President of the World Council of Churches, the Council of Bishops of Methodist Churches, the Head of the World Evangelical Alliance, the Mennonite Church, the Quaker leaders, a number of other Orthodox and Eastern Orthodox patriarchs, Catholic cardinals, archbishops, heads of national churches, heads of theological seminaries, well-known professors, preachers, and leading Christian scholars of Islam. Particularly remarkable was an open letter published in the New York Times in November 2007 from over 300 leading American evangelical and mainline leaders and Christian scholars, written and organized by Professor Miroslav Wolf and Yale Divinity School, entitled "Loving God and Neighborhood Together," Loving God and Neighbor Together. And it led to the first major A Common Word conference held at Yale University in July 2008. In the meantime, the leading Muslim scholars signing the initiative increased to over 300, with over 460 Islamic organizations and associations endorsing it. A number of spontaneous local grassroots and community level Christian Muslim initiatives of various kinds based on the open letter also sprung up all over the world in places as far as India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Canada, South Africa, the US, and Great Britain. A Common Word also became the subject of a number of MA and PhD dissertations in Western universities in various countries, including at Harvard University, Theological Seminary at the University of Tübingen, Germany, and the Center for Studies of Islam in the UK. And it was studied also in various international interfaith conferences and gatherings, including the World Economic Forum in spring 2008. Over 500 news articles in English alone, carried by thousands of press outlets, not to mention countless blogs, were written about the Common Word in its first year. During that time, it also became the center impetus behind the Wamp-Ellison resolution in the U.S. House of Representatives, which passed in 2008, commending it. The year ended with a second major international interfaith conference based on the document co-hosted by Cambridge University, the Royal Al-Bayt Institute for Islamic Thought, and His Grace the Archbishop of Canterbury, held at Cambridge University and then at the Lambeth Palace. In its second year, the Common Word functioned as a basis of a very important conference in the Vatican, the first Catholic Muslim Forum in November 2008, which was hosted by His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI, was held in Rome. Almost at the same time, the initiative was awarded Germany's Eugen Beiser Award of 2008 and the UK's Association of Muslim Social Scientists Building Bridges Award of 2008. Over the course of the second year, a number of academic books and journals were dedicated to the Common Word. Miroslav Wolf, Marisa Yerington, and His Royal Highness Prince Ghazi edited a book for Edermans, which will come out very soon, in a few months. There is another book being prepared by Professors Walid Al-Ansari and David Linen for Palgrave and Macmillan that will be published in 2010. Our hosts here at Georgetown published an occasional paper entitled A Common Word and the Future of Christian-Muslim Relations, edited by Dr. John Borelli. The journal Sophia dedicated an issue to it here in Washington, D.C., as did the Beirut Theological Seminary. And in Jordan, the Royal Al-Bayt Institute for Islamic Thought issued a white paper booklet, including all of its important texts so far. In assessing A Common Word after 2 years, it seems we shall ask ourselves the following two questions. First, did the open letter succeed in its stated goal, which was, quoting from the original text itself, invite Christians to come together with Muslims on the basis of what is common to Christians and Muslims, which is also what is most essential to Christians and Muslims in faith and practice, the two commandments of love. Second, we must ask ourselves if we have now come to realize the hope expressed at the end of the Common Word open letter, that we, as Muslims and Christians, respect each other, be fair, just, and kind to another, and live in sincere peace, harmony, and mutual goodwill. With regards to the first question, we may fairly conclude that we have just related all that we have just related, that a Common Word has indeed succeeded in bringing leading Christians and Muslims on the basis of the two greatest commandments of love, and has done so by the grace of God in a wondrous and unprecedented way. It's hard to think of a single letter that has such a widespread impact, and indeed of any instance in history when an interfaith theological document has had so much traction so quickly. That is not to say, of course, that all Muslims and Christians have responded in an unequivocally positive manner to this initiative, or that both sides have agreed that we understand the two commandments in exactly the same way. However, it cannot be denied that A Common Word did serve and continues to serve as a theological platform to bring fruitful Muslims and Christians together in a kind of worldwide peace movement, a peace movement which was never meant to deny or ignore all the doctrinal differences between Islam and Christianity, but rather simply to identify their common ground. The Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. Rowan Williams, we believe endorsed precisely this idea when he said in his response, to the Common Word on July 14, 2008, and I quote, "We find it in a hospitable and friendly spirit expressed in its focus on love of God and love of neighbor, a focus which draws together the language of Christianity and Islam and of Judaism also. Our belief is that only through a commitment to that transcendent perspective to which your letter points and to which we also look, shall we find the resources for radical, transforming, nonviolent engagement with the deepest needs of our world and our common humanity." End of quote. Equally important was the statement by His Holiness Pope Benedict XVI at the King Hussein Mosque in Jordan on Saturday, May 9th in 2009, where he said, "And the more recent Common Word letter, which echoed a theme consonant with my first encyclical, the unbreakable bond between love of God and love of the neighbor, and the fundamental contradiction of resorting to violence or exclusion in the name of God." We believe quite firmly that a peace initiative based on the two greatest commandments between monotheistic believers has a lot more potential than one based on just the second commandment, that is, or the golden rule, such as was proposed in the Congress prayer breakfast earlier this year, or such as is being proposed more universally by the Charter for Compassion. For whether we like it or not, devout Muslims, Christians, and Jews will find it difficult to get wholeheartedly behind a movement that does not mention God, thus inherently runs the risk of reducing the spiritual virtues of true love and compassion towards the neighbor to nothing more than mere emotion, sentimentality, or political nicety. That doesn't mean, of course, that we do not wholly support and applaud efforts to engage mankind on the basis of the golden rule. Obviously we do, for there is no other better way to engage everyone, believers and non-believers alike, in positive acts. However, we do believe that the theological platform of the Common Word has the greatest potential to engage Muslims, Christians, Jews, and others, other believers in God. God says in the Holy Quran, "Verily the remembrance of God is of all things the greatest." And also, is it not in the remembrance of God that hearts find their rest? Thank you.
Thank you much, very much, Ibrahim. Before we move to the invocation, amidst all of those great statements, I want to give you probably what I regard as the best one, which came in yesterday. It was posted on Faith, the Washington Post Newsweek website. And it was accompanied by the following cover letter. "It is my pleasure to present to you letters from the class of 2015 and 2016 at Pinnacle Academy in Oakton, Virginia. The letters are part of a project with On Faith called Letters of Hope and Advice and a response to the Common Word Initiative. Over the past week, we've learned about your efforts and held our own in-class peace and understanding dialogue. May the brave words and stories of our students inspire you, as well as other children around the world, to join the conversation. Thank you, Michel Bergeron." And here's the first letter. They're all wonderful letters, but here's the first one. "Dear Muslim and Christian leaders, my name is Kamal, and I'm an 11-year-old Turkish Muslim student at Pinnacle Academy, Virginia. I'm writing to support your efforts of peace between Muslims and Christians throughout the world. I think religious peace is important. In the past, I've been called a terrorist because of my religion. Although I know those who called me a terrorist were joking, it wasn't funny and I felt offended. I want to thank you for creating your organization and standing up for Muslims and Christians throughout the world. My goal for this world is to make 100% peace. War doesn't solve anything, dialogue solves everything. If we accomplish this goal, the world will be a better place. I will try everything I can in my community to promote peace too. Sincerely, Kamal." Now, I thank you. And the other letters are really just as remarkable. Now we move to the invocation. I'd like to call upon Bishop Charters and Dr. Ali Nayed to please come to the stage. Bishop John Charters is the 132nd Bishop of London. He's an ex officio member of the House of Lords, chairman of the Ecumenical London Church Leaders, and a director of the Coexist Foundation, a charity promoting interfaith understanding, and is associated with numerous other London organizations and responsible on behalf of the Archbishop of Canterbury for relations with the Orthodox churches. Dr. Arif Ali Nayed, a former professor at the Pontifical Institute of Arabic and Islamic Studies in Rome and the International Institute of Islamic Thought and Civilization in Malaysia, is the founder and director of Kalam Research and Media. He's a senior advisor to the Cambridge Interfaith Program and a fellow of the Royal Al Bayt Institute in Jordan. Bishop Chavez.
Father, we thank you for this place of learning. We thank you for the aspirations of the young. We thank you for all the gifts you've distributed among the members of this conference. We ask that you will deepen our understanding, enlarge our sympathies, and always make us mindful of the needs of the other. Almighty God, from whom all thoughts of truth and peace proceed, kindle, we pray thee, in the hearts of all people the true love of peace, and guide with thy pure and peaceable wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility thy kingdom may go forward till the earth is filled with the knowledge of thy love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد عبدك ونبيك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Lord, we thank you this morning for this morning. We wake up this morning and we see signs, آيات. These operative signs of yours are immediately apparent as we wake up. In the very waking up, there is a sign of our ultimate resurrection. There is a sign of dying and living again. In this morning, as we see the smiling faces of people walking by and of people offering us generously coffee in the morning, and in the sun that shines, and in the trees that sway in the morning breeze under the blue sky, we see signs of your creative power, and we see signs of your mercy and your compassion. We see signs in you giving life after death, and we see your glory in all of this. We see signs of hope and the new morning in this very gathering that is actually filling us with joy after a period of darkness, of great misunderstanding and conflict. We recognize, Lord, that this darkness continues, that there are conflicts everywhere. Our hearts go out to the victims of recent terrorism and the victims of war and bombardments, to the victims of siege and confinement in dreadful jails, to the victims of torture, and to the recent victims of floods and hurricanes everywhere. There is much darkness, but there is always light, and the light always inevitably comes, because, Lord, you are generous and merciful, and just as you take away, you give, and just as you destroy, you create, and just as you give the darkness, you give the light. We ask for your light. We ask for your guidance. We ask for you to show us capacity in our very incapacity, and to show us true divine power in our powerlessness. Lord, we thank you for bringing us together in your name, in your glory, and for your sake. You promised us through your prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that whenever people gather in your name to glorify your name and for your sake, that the angels form a funnel up to heaven, and that the heavens are pleased with our activity. We ask you, Lord, to bless this process, this common word process, and to make it a good word, like the good word you describe in the Quran, a good word that is rooted, that is authentically rooted, that is open to the heavens, that is fruitful, but above all, that is fruitful because of the permission of its Lord, because it is you, God, who creates, it is you who gives fruits. We are simply, Lord, trying to come together, acknowledging our weakness, acknowledging our need, acknowledging that we are weak and that we cannot do anything. And it is you, Lord, that creates. Make us, Lord, participants in this creation through the humble act of coming together in your love. Bless us, Lord, in this morning, and make these days fruitful days for all of humanity. Amen.
Well, now our marathon begins. I will again apologize to all of the speakers ahead of time for the constraints in terms of the length of time, and I will thank them for staying within that limit ahead of time. I'd like to call Sarah Joseph and the panelists for our first program on religious pluralism in the 21st century to please come to the stage. Sarah is the CEO and editor-in-chief of Emel magazine, a dynamic Muslim lifestyle magazine with a mainstream distribution in four international territories and subscribers in over 60 countries. She was a member of the Downing Street delegation in the aftermath of the July bombings and was a member of the Home Office Task Force on Extremism following on from that. In June 2004, Sarah was awarded an OBE, Order of the British Empire, for services to interfaith dialogue and the promotion of women's rights. This is the interesting one. She was also listed by Carter Anderson as one of the country's most powerful Muslims in the Muslim Power 100 list. Having said that, I should tell you that Sarah and I were involved in a debate in London, which we should have won, but which we lost. In any case, she's wonderful, but I dragged us down.
Yeah, and we lost by some margin, I tell you. I begin in the name of God, the merciful, the kind. All praises due to God, the Lord of all the worlds, and I greet you with a greeting of peace and mercy. It's such an honor to be here, and I thank you for the invitation to moderate, to attend this gathering and to be amongst you all. Special thanks has to go to President De Gioia, to Professor John Esposito, and to Prince Ghazi of Jordan, who is absent today. Now, my mother, a lapsed Catholic, she used to tell me this joke of the tour around heaven. And new arrivals were being shown around heaven, and you know, they're being shown the fountains and you know, the eternal fruits and the fine silks and you know, generally the nice gardens, and they're all pretty pleased to be there. And St. Peter is the tour guide, and he's taking them round. And at the end, St. Peter says to the group, "Do you have any questions?" And one man tentatively raises his hand, and he says, "What are the walls for?" And he said, "Oh, the walls. Well, they're there for the Catholics, to make them think that they're the only ones there." All the non-Catholics are wondering, can we laugh at that joke? But you know, you can replace St. Peter and you can replace the Catholics with the Baptists, the Presbyterians, Jews, and definitely the Muslims, because all of our traditions pretty much have a sort of exclusivist bent to be found just about. And this sort of exclusivism manifests itself in a sort of variety of interesting ways. When my son was six, he was told by another Muslim boy, "You know these Jews and Christians, they're blind. They can't see us Muslims." And my son, who was six, raises himself up and says, "Listen, my grandma's a Christian and she can see me." And about 3 years later, a little less funnily, his Arabic teacher told him, "You know these Jews and these Christians, they're all going to hell." And I think it took a fair amount of courage for a 9-year-old to turn around and tell his teacher, but he turned around and said to him, "Listen, my grandma's a Christian and she's not going to hell." And when he returned home later that day, he was pretty upset, and I showed him the verse of the Quran that says, "Those who believe, and the Jews and the Christians and the Sabians, all who believe in God in the last day and do good, they shall have their reward from their Lord, and there is no fear for them, and nor shall they grieve." And he felt validated, and at the end of the term, the Arabic teacher came to me and he says, I do hope I haven't put him off Islam, but he's taught me a lot this term. And I was like, that's kind of the wrong way around. But this verse is obviously very inclusive. Yet there are Muslims who manage to be very exclusive, condemning some fellow Muslims to hell. For them, heaven is a small club, and I'm not sure even I'd make it. And in contrast, you know, I've met Christians and had talks with senior clergymen who have tried to find a way for me, a Muslim, to get into heaven through Jesus Christ. But what if I don't want to be saved that way? But what does it matter? Surely we're talking about pluralism in the 21st century. Surely our different perceptions post this world, what's going to happen to us after this world, do they affect how we deal with each other? Do they affect how we treat each other? If we can't imagine sharing heaven together with each other, how does that affect our relationship in this world? Won't it deeply impact our relationship? Won't it affect our ability to work on our understanding of worldly pluralism? Then again, perhaps we can put aside the other side and just get on with it. Say, let's just say God is unity and everything else is diversity. Can we get on with the practical issues facing us on this side of life? How do we get along? How do we find a way to live together? And how can we serve together? What common words can we find to build a better common future? And to unpack these themes and more, we have an eminent panel and distinguished panel. We have Father Tom Michel, Bishop Younan, Dr. Ingrid Mattson, and Dr. Joel Hunter, and I'll give more in-depth CVs when I introduce them personally. As you heard from Professor John Esposito, we know that they could all enthrall us with their insights for the whole length of this entire session. However, I'm being ordered to be, was it aggressive, John? God help me, I'm not really aggressive as a person, but I am going to ask them to respect the time to throw a few ideas into the pot in just 5 minutes. Is this some kind of small miracle? Dear God, please send one down. Each. And then with your involvement, because yesterday we didn't have enough time. There was a queue of people and they didn't get involved. With your involvement to cook these ideas into a truly amazing session. So I'm going to ask Father Tom Michel to be the first speaker. Father Michel is a visiting fellow of the Woodstock Theological Center at Georgetown University since 2008. He was ordained a Catholic priest in 1967 and entered the Society of Jesus 2 years later. His studies have taken him to Egypt, Lebanon, and the US, during which time he studied Arabic and Islamic studies, as well as receiving his doctorate in Islamic theology from the University of Chicago. In 1981, Father Michel began work in the Vatican's Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue, where he became head of the Office of Relations with Muslims. He's also taught in Turkey. And he is also the Secretary for Interreligious Dialogue for the Jesuits based in Rome, Father Tom Michel.
Good morning, everyone. In recent years, I've often taught courses and given lectures mainly on Christian theology in Muslim institutions in various countries, mainly Turkey and Iran, Indonesia, Malaysia. And I should add that the experience has been really enriching for me, and I hope also for my Muslim students and colleagues. I'm convinced that God has used these encounters to make me into a better Christian. And I'm hopeful that God has been just as active with God's grace to lead my friends to become better Muslims. On other occasions, I've been on search committees and helped to hire Muslims to teach about their faith and related subjects in various Christian institutions. Now, this kind of cooperation, which enables us to work together and share our experiences, of God in our lives is for me an invaluable form of engagement. But I often find myself asking, is this as far as we can go? Is this the best we can do? It's obviously a good thing for Christians to include Muslims in their projects and institutions, and for Muslims to include Christians in their good works. But doesn't this still remain a rather timid and careful kind of cooperation? When we Christians enlist the collaboration of Muslims in our projects, we maintain control. The vision is ours, and the level and type of Muslim cooperation is what we permit, and with the people that we choose. If tensions or conflicts of vision occur, we can solve the problem rather easily by putting an end to the cooperation because we have retained full control. The same obviously applies to Muslims who involve Christians in their projects. Now, reflecting on the third chapter, or the third part of A Common Word, I think that what the world needs to see is Muslims and Christians working together on an equal basis to serve humanity. This is especially important in our world where many people have convinced themselves that religion is the common cause of fanaticism, division, and violence in our world. Our contemporaries need to see Christians and Muslims working together in friendship, service, and in witness to human and divine values. Imagine a region that has been torn apart by suspicion, conflict, or even warfare between Christians and Muslims. And imagine the role of reconciliation that could be played by schools or social agencies that were truly Muslim-Christian in inspiration, sponsorship, and administration. Think of the message that would be sent not only to students or clients of such institutions, but also to their families, neighbors, and co-nationals, that Muslims and Christians can work together for the common good. But there's a basic obstacle that has to be overcome before we can achieve that level of cooperation. It is the lack of trust. We don't trust each other enough to commit ourselves, our time, our energies, our funds to joint projects that we would no longer control. The problem, I think, is broader than this. The lack of trust is a pervasive problem that affects Christian-Muslim relations in many parts of the world. It's one that deserves our serious attention. Why is it so hard for us to trust one another? And secondly, the difficult question, how do you build trust? Trust is so difficult to establish, and yet it's so fragile and easy to destroy. Now, I would contend that we don't trust one another because of the burden of history that we all carry. We could all draw up a list of times and ways that we have been wronged or betrayed or oppressed or dominated by the other. How do we move beyond these painful memories so that we can live and work together better? And in this context, we have to talk more about the human values of honesty, sincerity, patience, and forgiveness in our mutual relations, straightforwardness, no two-faced attitudes or hidden agendas. We have to talk about when I'm honest with you, it's easier for you to trust me. When I'm sincere with you, it's easier for you to trust me. When we pray together before God, it's easier to trust one another. Because our betrayals of trust were not only in the distant past, but we can But we continue to break down the trust that has been precariously built. Forbearance and more forgiveness are necessary if we're going to cooperate and live together in the ways that God wants. One might say that the Common Word Initiative itself grew out of a creative and generous response to remarks that could have set relations between the two communities on a hostile and unproductive course. So, what is the Common Word ideal? It calls Muslims and Christians, and I'll quote it, to let our differences not cause hatred and strife between us. Let us vie with each other in righteousness and good works. Let us respect each other. Let's be fair and just and kind to one another and live in sincere peace, harmony, and mutual goodwill. Now there is a project worth working for. When I read that, I think of the Second Vatican Council document at the Catholic Church, which is remarkably similar in tone and intent. It says, and I close with this, since in the course of centuries, not a few quarrels and hostilities have arisen between Christians and Muslims, we urge all to forget, to move beyond the past, and to work sincerely for mutual understanding and preserve and promote together for the benefit of all mankind, social justice, moral values, peace, and freedom. How do we build the trust that we need to attain these ideals? Thank you.
Father Michel makes a profound point about the erosion of trust in our society. We cease to trust our politicians, our media, and how does that impact on our trusting each other? He talked about conflict zones. Well, here's a man who is coming from a conflict zone. Bishop Dr. Munib Younan is a bishop of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Jordan and the Holy Land. He is a vice president of Asia to the Lutheran World Federation and is instrumental in on-the-ground initiatives to promote peace, reconciliation, and justice. Bishop Younan has explored the question of what makes peace from a Palestinian Christian perspective. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for the common word that I can also myself for the first time be in Georgetown University. And I think it is very essential that the common word has put behind us comparative religion and has helped us to seek the common values among the religions, Christianity and Islam, and also Judaism, that promote justice, peace, reconciliation, freedom, toleration. I have 3 points, and of course, I can expand on every point, but my time is very short. One. Religious leaders are called from the common word to be prophetic for justice. We have to address justice. Prince Ghazi, in his Yale speech, said, if the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is not solved, then we continue to have problems in the world. And I agree, for the Muslim and Arab world, the litmus test of the West and European Union and US, if they can bring justice for the Palestinian-Israeli conflict in one standard of justice, two-state solution and Church Jerusalem. The heads of churches in Jerusalem spoke on Jerusalem, it should be shared for the 3 monotheistic religions and the 2 nations, Palestinians and Israelis. Once we solve the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, then I can assure you, antisemitism, Islamophobia, and Christianophobia will decrease and end in our world. We need prophetic justice. Thirdly, I am an Arab Christian. I don't consider myself a minority, nor am I living in a ghetto. I can give you our Jordanian model. I have equal rights, and I have at the same time equal responsibilities. I am integral part of the whole Arab world. I have a role to play. I have not to sit only and say, I want to speak about religious freedom. I have the full religious freedom in Jordan. What is my role as an Arab Christian is also to show my responsibility in building a modern civil society. And more than that, I must be the voice of Islam to the West and to Christianity. And I demand from Arab Muslims in Jordan also to be the voice of Arab Christianity to the Muslim world. By this way, we can then speak on pluralism. Pluralism is not a theory. For me, it's an everyday practice, an everyday work. My third point, to be just short, religious leaders must work for prophetic diaconia. I want to tell you some examples just to go. The Lutheran World Federation has a big world service system that is $85 billion serving the whole world. The Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, 16 million development program in the world. My church has schools, 45% of our students are Muslim. We don't convert them. We want them to be good Muslims in Lutheran schools. But at the same time, we have Muslim charities who are in the world working on their own. I believe the common world invites us Muslims and Christians for a prophetic diaconia, not to work alone, but to eradicate poverty in the world, to eradicate diseases, pandemics, and epidemics from the world. What about if we are more than half of the world, if we put our money together for prophetic diaconia to eradicate poverty, to promote gender balance in the world, to work for a diaconia that helps people, you see, to have life and life in dignity. We are not speaking of a prophetic diaconia of charity. We don't want charity for the world. The poor do not want charity. They want justice. This is the reason when we work together for this justice, we will not allow then those poor countries to be in the bosom of extremism, for injustice and poverty grow where poverty is. For this reason, it's our duty to give life and life abundantly to every human being, be it Palestinian, Israeli, Jew, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, African, Asian. It's our role to have a prophetic diaconia together and not everyone alone. I want to end, but I know my time is short and we bishops don't know how to constrain ourselves with time. You see, I want to end with a parable from the Middle East. You know, religious leaders from the Middle East got an invitation to go to hell and to heaven. So they went, the first stop was in hell. So they went to hell, and in hell, they were everybody thin, slim, do not feel well. And at the same time, they asked them, you have food on your tables, but why are you thin and sick? They said, they give us long spoons, and we cannot eat the food with these long spoons by ourselves. They said, okay. Then they went the next stop to heaven. In heaven, they also saw the same abundance of food, the same spoons, but people were healthy. They were very well, they were well fitted. They were not anemic like in hell. And then the head of the delegation of the religious leaders asked them, but how come that you are healthy and you have the same food in heaven as it's in hell? He said, yes, we have big spoons, but with these big spoons, we first feed our neighbor. By that way, we are fed. For this reason, we are healthy. I tell you, the common word must invite us for prophetic diaconia that Mumprat promote, not loving the neighbor by word, but by deed. For John tells us, those who say, I love God and hate their brother and sisters are liars. Let's together work for prophetic leadership for justice and diaconia in our broken world. Thank you very much.
That's wonderful, Bishop Younan. When I told him it was 5 minutes, he was not convinced he could do it, but you very, very nearly did, and it was absolutely inspirational. When I told my children that parable about the spoons, being literalists, as children often are, they got spoons and they got long sticks, and they put string round so that they had these very long spoons, and they attempted to work out whether they could indeed feed themselves with long spoons, or did it work out better to feed each other? It was a real mess, particularly with the carrot soup. Anyway, our next speaker is Dr. Ingrid Mattson, and it's a real honour to introduce her. She is the Professor of Islamic Studies, the Founder and Director of the Islamic Chaplaincy Programme and Director of the McDonald Centre of Islamic Studies and Christian-Muslim Relations at Hartford Seminary in Hartford. In 2006, Dr. Mattson was elected President of the Islamic Society of North America, the first woman to ever be elected to the post. And I think it rightly said it caused a stir, didn't it? A little bit, no? You were already vice president for 2 terms, but it was a wonderful thing, and you never know, one day in Britain we may replicate it, but I think that's a long while coming. Dr. Mattson, thank you.
Good morning. Well, when I was given this topic, I actually took the idea of the 21st century seriously, and I started to think about what this century is going to look like. We're already a decade into it, and I cannot pretend to know what the world will look like in 50 or 60 or 80 years from now. But there are going to be some enormous pressures, I can see, even at this point, on our ability to engage with each other, on the ability of our religious traditions to have a meaningful impact in the world for justice. And I think we need to take into account these structural pressures seriously if we're going to have an effective engagement. I could judge the age of this audience if I ask you, raise your hand if you know the significance of 2012, the year 2012. About five people. So the rest of you can look it up. In 5 years from now, in any case, our children know, those who are teenagers and younger know that the world's going to be transformed into a age of Aquarius. So none of what I say has any significance for them. But for the rest of you religious leaders, you should be aware of this, of what your children are really thinking. But let's think about some of these pressures. First of all, we will have technology tools that will help us, or at least those for whom these tools are available, to drastically improve the quality of human life, especially in terms of health, human health, and longevity. These will cause enormous pressures on our bioethics. Second, our governments will have more and more tools to intrude in our lives. Already, privacy is almost meaningless in a modern technological society, and these tools will only become more intrusive and employed potentially to control us even more than they are now. Third, we will have more effective weapons that can be used particularly in an impersonal manner to harm others, bioterrorism, as well as bombing and targeting people from on high or from a distant location from thousands of miles away, so that our almost outdated doctrines of just warfare will certainly become virtually meaningless in the 21st century. Fourth, even greater gap between the rich and the poor. All of these things that we are developing to make our lives better will remain inaccessible to the world's poor, and so this gap between the privileged and the underprivileged will increase. We will perhaps end up with a religion of people who are wealthy, those are us folks, and the faith of the poor people. And then finally, of course, there will be greater religious diversity everywhere, so that Christians will be in places where there never were Christians before, or not for a long time, and there will be Muslims in places in the world where they have not been, at least in significant numbers. So what do these structural challenges say to us? To me, it's a very sobering reminder that our common challenges are enormous, and that unless we develop a common ethics that address these issues, our faith traditions will become irrelevant in the face of overwhelming power, privilege, and disparity. What I love about the common word is that it is transnational and transcendent, and I believe that employed effectively, we can together meet some of these enormous challenges and possibly be that voice for justice and peace that we claim we want to be. But it will require enormous courage. It will require us to more than ever to push back against the appropriation of religion by political power. It will require us to seriously consider what it means for us to value the dignity of human life in an era of transnational corporations that even more than ever have the ability to drastically affect the course of life itself and the way that life is constituted. It means that we will have to seriously take the global economic and financial order seriously, unless we do have, we end up in a state where our greatest religious difference or divide is not between Christians and Muslims, but as I said, between poor Christians and Muslims and wealthy Christians and Muslims. How do we go about this challenge? Certainly co-education. At Hartford Seminary, where I teach, and my president, Heidi Hadso, is a global ethicist herself, we teach Christians and Muslims together. They learn together. Co-education is not the education of men and women together, although we have that, but the education of Christians and Muslims together. Unless we are formed in our religious education in a context, a realistic context, a context in which we will live in this world, I think we'll be very limited in our ability to impact these very sobering challenges. Second, on a more happy note, let me say, I think that if we continue to do our co-education, some co-education at a younger level, I think we will be able to push back against another sobering reality, which is that the growth of a dominant and radical atheism. We already see that our lives, and we notice that our lives, our public lives, are devoid of sacred spaces, sacred sounds, the church bells, the adhan. Increasingly, these things have faded away, and we drive down the street or we walk down the street, and we see very little that reflects sacred space or time or life. One of the things that I found has very much enriched my life is the fact that now when I drive down the street, so many of those churches and synagogues are places that I consider spiritual homes as well. Not that I have entered them to become a Christian or a Jew, but I've entered them as a faithful person who has participated to some extent in the remembrance of God in those places. And I think that with the education of our children, that if we encourage this at least sometimes to visit each other's houses of worship and to have that opportunity to experience the transcendent reality, at least in some measure, in each other's houses of worship, that we will find that our lives, our ordinary mundane lives, are enriched, because as we go about our daily lives, we will see these reminders of God's presence that are not only our own houses of worship, but these other places as well. Finally, let me say that I think we also have to be prepared for a backlash against multi-religious work and interfaith work. And that is because not only will we have our harmony and cooperative work together, but there are increasing numbers of people in younger generations who consider themselves not only multi-ethnic, multi-racial, but multi-religious, because they come from families where there are people from different religious traditions, or they have friends from different religious traditions. And this is something that terrifies religious leaders. We don't want syncretism. We are confused by kids who say, and there are many of them who will say, well, I'm a Christian Muslim, or I'm a Jewish Christian. And what they mean by that is they feel they have a bit of a home or friends in one tradition and another. I believe that will create that, and some other developments will create a backlash against the kind of work that we do, and we have to be prepared for that, to calm down a little bit when we hear some of these things that we don't understand, and simply continue with the work that we're doing with an eye open to these new developments. Thank you.
Yeah. 2012, I was almost going to put my hand up and say, London's got the Olympics, but I don't think that's what Dr. Mattson was talking about. Hopefully we'll have our roads and things in place by then. Our final speaker of the panel is Dr. Joel Hunter. Dr. Hunter has served as a senior pastor of Northland, a church distributed in a congregation of 12,000 that worships at 4 sites in Metro Orland and more than 1,000 sites via the interactive webcasts. Dr. Hunter serves on the board of the World Evangelical Alliance, which has 420 million constituents, and the National Association of Evangelicals, which represents 30 million members. Recently, he was appointed to the President's Advisory Council on Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnerships, which will advise President Barack Obama on substantive policy issues. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. We've heard that healthy pluralism does not dilute or deny our own specific theology and identity. Rather, it informs and completes, that's an important word, our attempts to focus on God. Permit me a personal and imperfect analogy. When I was a little child, we had a gang of boys that played together. And we pretty much decided that girls, with the exception of our sisters and mothers, were disgusting. We didn't want to play with them. They messed up our play. And so we pretty much just dismissed them. As I developed a little more, they went from disgusting to just strange. They would giggle when you said hi. Or they would cry when you teased them or made a face at them. How very odd, we thought. When I developed a little more, girls began to have rather attractive attributes. There was a girl that I knew in my chemistry class that taught me how to understand formulas. And I really was intrigued with the way she thought, with her dexterity of mind. There was another girl that I knew that just wanted to have a conversation instead of compete on something, which was something very new to a young man with, you know, surging manly aspirations. I was intrigued by that. And finally, one day when I met my wife, I learned that she possessed the missing part of my brain as well as the fulfillment of my heart. In the biblical story of creation, there's only one place in which God says it is not good. It's when he looks at the man who is alone and says, it's not good that the man should be alone. And so the Bible says that I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Hebrew word here means corresponding one, or one who answers, or as I like to tell my congregation, the biblical definition of a wife is one who talks back. As that story goes on, he makes her out of the man, but he brings her to the man because she is in a different place. Not just literally, but figuratively. She has a different perspective that he needs in order to complete him, and in order to do his work in the garden. I think the story is true of Christians and Muslims. I think that we are, in some ways, made by a sovereign God to complete one another, and that we are supposed to look upon one another as having some aspect of our completion and to work together in the garden. A sovereign God who is universal should be evident outside one's own faith tradition. He should come to us outside of that faith with which we are familiar. Indeed, Jesus, when he encountered faith outside his own religious tradition, rejoiced. He also looked to creation, not an automatic communicator of faith, as a vehicle of faith. And so we are taught to look toward that which is not included in our own faith tradition as being a vehicle or a venue of God's revelation to us. That is part of his sovereignty as well as his universality. And so I think that our job is not to look at each other, and we've already gotten past this, just with tolerance. That's almost sophomoric. Or even merely cooperation. Or merely even learning more about each other and growing in our own faith. I think that a sovereign God has so orchestrated this universe that each part actually needs the other part to complete its own journey, its own function. And I think that our motivation for working together in the future needs to be not just equality and justice, although those are very important and indispensable values, but I think we need to look at each other as needed complementary, with an E, completing facets of the journey that God has called us onto. Shukran, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hunter. And this idea of completing one another, it reminds me of a Quranic verse where God says, I could have created you all the same. I could have made you all the same. But he created us different, into different nations, different tribes, so that we could know one another, not so that we could hate one another. And in our diversity, we somehow come to know God's unity. In knowing each other, we can know God. Now, our panel have been absolutely wonderful in keeping to time, and I thank them so much that they did that without me having to be aggressive, as I was asked to be. And I would hope that the audience now, it's your turn. And that you will be as wonderfully respectful to the time as they have been. So come out, make your comments, keep it pithy, keep it succinct, and then we can really have a conversation. So you can begin your cue, and as you do so, please come up and introduce yourselves. Introduce yourselves briefly. Going to be a long queue, so really, you guys, we've got to get all of this in, and we do need to be pithy.
Good morning, my name is Ahmad Shaheen, I'm from Notre Dame. I would like to start by thanking the panelists for very inspiring and very profound statements. We were asked by Professor Esposito to press the panelists a little bit, so I'd like just to press for a roadmap. We heard, just as a reminder, as you all know, the dialogue or intergenerational dialogue between Muslims and Christians is almost half a century old. It's not new. So if the panelists, each one of them would like just to give us a brief idea about a roadmap, plan of action, where to go from there, actually. Co-education has been around for over a century and a half. Other interrelational dialogues and so on have been around for a long time for what exactly we need to do to promote pluralism, practical pluralism between Christians and Jews and Muslims as well. Thank you.
That was Father Michel. You spoke about Muslims and Christians working together to serve humanity. Could you begin the roadmap? Where would you start?
Well, I think the reality of our world today is many people are convinced that religion is a cause of dispute, it's a cause of conflict, it's something that sets humanity back. Now, I think that we Christians and Muslims are called by God to make a contribution that otherwise would not be made in our world. We have to bear witness to what I mentioned as humane and divine values. We can only do this, I'm convinced, if we do it together. We have to find ways of understanding ourselves as being on the same side, making a contribution together in our world. Now, there's many ways that this can be done. Common projects is one. But I think that we share so much, and even we share a mission together. This is what the Second Vatican Council was saying. It took four key areas of modern life: peace building, moral values, social justice, true human freedom, in which together we are supposed to be building. From a Catholic point of view, over 40 years now, we've had a common mission with Muslims, if we take seriously our Second Vatican Council teaching. That, to me, is a start of a roadmap, or part of a roadmap.
Bishop Younan, I mean, roadmap in your part of the world isn't the greatest term, is it? But pluralism, you said, is not a theory, it is a reality in Jordan. How is it a reality? Can you give some tangible examples of reality?
Well, I want, of course, you are right. When we speak on roadmap, you know, always in the Middle East, we are afraid we have many roadmaps, but we don't have a map. We have a road, but without a map, you see. And this is the reason, you know, I want really, what I would like to say to reality. You know, when we speak on Muslim-Christian relations, two things are important. We must have a local roadmap within the one country. How do they live together? And I speak it with all responsibility. For example, when we speak on citizenship, in certain countries, for example, some European countries, can you be, for example, a German and a Muslim? Can you be in certain, in Bangladesh, I was in Bangladesh, can you be a Bangladeshi and a Christian? I believe it has to start locally to clarify what does it mean. When we clarify it locally, as we have done in Palestine and in Jordan, then we can work globally. This is the reason when I called for a global agenda. Because at home, we are living in peace. I mean, not the political situation, but the religious situation, we are living in peace. When I am living in peace at home with other religions, we can together then put a roadmap how we can really, if you like it, if I use a Christian terminology, evangelize the world with diaconia.
Okay. Evangelizing the world always scares people, though. I have to be honest. Do either of the you want to contribute, or shall I go to the next question?
Huh? Up to you. Well, I'll just say quickly that I don't think we have coeducation. We have coeducation maybe at the level of some religious leaders, but there's a huge disjunction between the way we educate and form our children within their religious tradition and any interfaith we do. Until now, still, our religious education for our children in many ways is to create a very clear-cut identity, religious identity around them to protect them from others and other identities, and then encourage them to do some community service projects so that we can show them that, we can show other people that Muslims are really nice people or Christians make a contribution to the world. So until we integrate this ethical vision, that we have a shared responsibility as people of faith, as the faith community, I don't think we're really going anywhere. So that's what my recommendation.
Okay, can I take the next question? Next question, please, thank you.
Father Haddad from Jordan again. I'm another Arab Christian that you'll hear this morning. When we talk about the common world, we talk about a history that we enjoy back there in the Middle East, in Jordan, for example, in the Holy Land. We are talking about 14 centuries of coexistence. When we talk about common world, I believe we have very tangible examples that we can use back from our region. If you don't mind, I'd like just to share with the audience an example. About 10 years ago, we had an iftar banquet for 250 Muslim leaders in Amman. One of our Christian colleagues said, "Yani, what a waste to spend all that money on Muslims during the month of Ramadan." And when I saw him, he said, "I asked him. I said." I listened to your comment, I received it, and I looked really in the Bible, and you were right, I did not find any place where it says that our Lord Jesus Christ hosted an iftar banquet to Muslims. And he thought, you know, more than wasting the money, he thought that I didn't have that sense of history. And he said, you don't know that during the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, there were no Muslims. I said, yes, and you don't know that during the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, there were no Christians. And so I also use that, the same thing with my Muslim colleagues, that remember, during the time of the Prophet Muhammad, there were no Muslims. When we talk about pluralism, when we talk about prejudice, please let's remember that love, we are human, and I believe the love, and this is the common word, the love is the strongest and the best tool to reach out to the other. Why don't we start the initiatives, personal initiatives at every level? I would like to hear from the panelists, please.
All right, what I'm going to do, that's excellent. Although, of course, you could get Muslims who'd say that actually there's been Muslims since the beginning of time as verbs, not nouns, because it literally means to surrender yourself unto God. And actually the Quran describes Abraham as a Muslim, i.e. somebody who surrenders to God. But what I'm going to do with this, the queue is very, very long and worryingly long. So I'm going to take it in threes and then we can get some feedback. And I'm going to actually close the queue for the moment and then I'll see how I go, because otherwise there's no point. People will be standing up for nothing. So I'm closing the queue. And we're taking it in three. So I've done one, Father Haddad. Now take two more, and then we'll come back to the panel for those three.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Welcome, sir.
In my experience, it's easy to convince Jews and Christians that Islam is a religion of compassion and tolerance than it is to convince Muslims. For example, the verse that you cited, that if you are a Jew, if you are a Christian, if you are a Muslim, if you are a Sabian, you have nothing to worry and nothing to fear. Every mosque where I have talked about this verse, I have never been invited again in this country. Every time I have recited the verse, imams have popped up, and there are witnesses here who have cited other verses from the Quran saying that any one of you who chooses any other religion other than Islam on the day of judgment, you are a loser. People cite the Surah Bayyinat to very clearly say that the Quran is clear. the Christians and Jews, if they do not believe in Muhammad, their final destination is hell. So my point to you is that if leaders, if Muslim, Christian, and Jewish leaders march ahead on this wonderful agenda of the common word and leave behind the masses, then I think this project is not really going to take off.
Leave behind?
The masses.
Oh, the masses, right.
I think it is going to be far more difficult to convince even Muslims in America about the equal moral and spiritual worth of Jews and Christians. Try doing it in my mosque, I challenge you. This is an important part, convincing people that people of other religions have the same privileges or have the same ability to go to heaven. And I think that the common word agenda would be doing a disservice if it did not also parallelly sell this idea within the communities itself. And I think, I don't want to talk about what Christians and Jews are saying about Muslims in America or in Europe for that matter. But just talking within the Muslim community, I think it's far more difficult to sell the idea that Islam recognizes the moral worth of Christians and Jews if they do not accept Muhammad, okay, than it is to tell others. And I want to know what we would do that.
We'll come back to that. We'll hear the third one. Thank you very much for your point. Next one.
Hi, Mark Lance. I'm a professor here at Georgetown. I've been thinking all morning about another famous ecumenical religious letter, King's letter from the Birmingham jail. And I've been thinking about that because at many points in American history, churches have taken it that love of neighbor required a rather more active confrontation with the forces that were oppressing those neighbors. I think of the network of white churches that formed the Underground Railroad that freed escaped slaves, all of it done feloniously under the Fugitive Slave Act, many of whom were hung for their trouble. Or some of my early activist mentors who were part of this sanctuary movement in the 70s and 80s that sheltered those escaping from the terrorist wars in Latin America, again, all of us risking jail time for that. And of course, the role of the black church in the civil rights movement. Certainly dialogue went on, but equally importantly, as a place for facilitating strategy, tactics, and organizing of the boycott of segregated institutions, the occupation of segregated businesses. My question is, what more active things understanding reconciliation, not to say love, of the Muslim world might imply for Americans at this point in history? Because it seems to me that in a world in which my country is currently occupying two nations and facilitating a third occupation, has its troops in dozens of countries where they're not welcome, is producing more than half the weapons in the world, this has some rather concrete implications for my obligations if I'm to take words like understanding and love and reconciliation seriously. And I'm just wondering if folks think that there's something to be learned from King's statement as much as there is from discussion of dialogue. Thank you.
Well, some powerful themes there, from love to how do you as leaders take the masses with you, to King's letter and, you know, that focus on excessive militarism and what do we do with that and how does that approach our love of neighbor and positive action. So perhaps Dr. Hunter, you begin. And then
let me start with just the fundamentals that I think addresses all three of these questions. I very much like the point that several of you have made that says this needs to be a movement, a grassroots. You can't talk about ideas up here and not involve the congregations or the constituencies for which you have responsibility. For me, as a pastor, that means several things. First of all, that means that I build relationships with Muslims, because everything comes from relationships. The world operates by relationships. It doesn't operate mainly by theology. When it comes right down to it, what Dr. Joseph said about her grandson and him being able to be a voice out of his love for his grandmother, that's what changes things. And so when I speak to my congregation and I talk about my Muslim friend, or I talk about the project that our students have just had with the Muslim and Jewish students in town, That gives them permission to have a different perspective on these huge social issues that they don't know what to, they don't know what to do with those. But they know that if they have an investment, if they really do begin to care about another person from another faith, that will shape everything they do from then on. And so as a pastor, my responsibility in these huge questions is to go personal and to talk about the relationships that I've had and to encourage others to have relationships and to work together. And that will filter up to a larger theological understanding and certainly a larger justice impact.
I can't see very well with the lights, but that sounded like Muqtadir Khan, who was talking about the what he perceived to be intolerance on the part of people in his community. I think we have to be careful about a few things. One, first of all, not to make sure that we're dealing with facts, not just anecdotes. I mean, when we look at some of the polling that Dalia Mugahid has done at Gallup on attitudes, you know, Muslim American attitudes. I think many people were surprised to see how that, for example, Muslim Americans were the most politically progressive or liberal among all faith groups after American Jews. Does that translate to their, theological liberalism? I don't know. It would be interesting to do some polling on that. But whatever that number might be, the common word does not require everyone to be a theological pluralist, meaning that we do not all have to believe that all paths lead equally to God for us to come together on this common word. It's possible, you know, Sarah articulated a vision of, you know, sort of all good people will go to heaven, an interpretation of the Quranic verse that way. Some people interpret it that way, some people don't. The issue is, and it's true in Christianity as well, historically most Muslims are theological exclusivists. The question is, does that mean that they're ethical exclusivists as well? And I don't think that's the case. I think it's perfectly possible to believe that there is a common ethical platform that people can share, good work that people can do. Even Ibn Khaldun said that. He said there are some rules for behavior in society, ethical principles, that even those who have had no divine revelation or access to it would develop simply because it's necessary for the well-functioning and peaceful functioning of society. So I don't think we have to require that as much as it, you know, some of us may desire it or some of us may not. So I think we have to be careful not to conflate these things. And this is why I believe it will be much more productive if we focus on ethics.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think, you know, we have to be, as religious leaders, honest with ourselves. Maybe sometimes we are the problem, not the religion. And I think, you know, once this honesty is there, we can solve many problems. And in the Middle East, you know, I want to say we as religious leaders, even if sometimes some people don't like us, but as a religious leader, what I say or don't say, I am respected and I am followed. If I call people for peace, they follow me. If I call people for toleration, they follow me. If I call them for war, they will follow me. This is the reason we have a key position in the Middle East. I was speaking from my experience. I can give two examples, if you allow me shortly. One, when we had the Prophet Muhammad cartoon crisis, I said, you know, when in Europe they sneeze, we get the flu in Jerusalem and in the Middle East. And for me, I called for a code of conduct. And we cooperated with the Royal Jordanian Coexistence Center and the Church of Norway. And we held, you know, a conference for Muslim and Christian leaders in Jordan, 48 Christian and Muslim leaders attended and signed a document of conduct about respecting each other's holy symbols, holy writings, holy places, free access to holy places. And I tell you, it infiltrated to the grassroots so easily because they saw the leader are leading and are not led. The second example I want to say is about what we have established in Jerusalem. You know, in the somebody yesterday spoke about Alexandria Declaration. Alexandria Declaration does not exist anymore. We have a spin of it. We established the Council of Religious Institutions in the Holy Land, where Trond Bakkevik, who is with us here, is the convener. And we have the two chief rabbis of Israel, and we have the heads of the local churches, Catholic, Orthodox, Lutherans, and Anglicans. And we have also the chief judge of the Islamic court and the minister of Waqf in Palestine. And I tell you, we have achieved three things that are important. One, we have established a hotline to monitor any derogatory remarks against the other. And what we got, what imams, clergy, and rabbis are saying, sometimes it's shameful. We have to repent as religious leaders. The second point, we are at the moment monitoring 100 textbooks in Palestine and Israel. What do they teach about the other? In 1 year, we know no other about what is. When we start with education with the children, there can be a change. A third point, and the last point, what we are doing is Jerusalem. It's Jerusalem. You know, it's Jerusalem. Can Jerusalem be shared? Can Jerusalem have justice? These are what we are doing in practice, and it infiltrates to our grassroots.
Excellent. Father Michel.
Yeah, in reflecting on the letter from prison by Martin Luther King, one of the key areas that we ought to be, have to be cooperating is in that of justice. I could give dozens of examples, mostly from, I've lived in Asia most of the time. I'll just be content with one because it'll give you an idea. There's a group of people on the island of Basilan in the southern Philippines, Muslims and Christians, who are monitoring daily, weekly, the disappearances and the summary arrests of people. People report that somebody is missing. They're going to the prison. They're bothering the military authorities to find out where they are, who they are, what's happened to them. They're doing this at quite a bit of risk to their own personal safety to do so. I believe this is, these are not elite people. These are ordinary people. They're farmers. They're fishermen and fisher women. And they're doing this, why? Because they see this as something important to do. I could give 20 examples if I had the time. I think that's an important part of our engagement.
Right. So a lot of belief in ethics and justice is coming through from the panel. Reminds me of a Quranic verse, be just, for the justice is the closest thing to God consciousness. Okay, we've actually got six people, which gives me two trios, so we're going to go through the next three. And I think time-wise, as long as we're all quite smart, we could actually manage it. Okay, thank you, Hisham.
I'll try to be smart.
Thank you.
Hisham Helia from the University of Warwick. Thank you very much for your comments and your analysis over the last couple of hours. Make my comments extremely brief. Thank you in particular to the Bishop for mentioning the examples of Christians in the Holy Land and how you don't identify yourselves as a minority. And speaking as a European, I find that incredibly important. I, as a European, feel very grateful to be in Europe. I hope and pray that my fellow European citizens who follow the Muslim faith can be able to stand up and speak as you did for generations to come. But as I look back over the past few years, particularly after the 7th of July bombings in 2005, I can't say I'm all that certain that will be the case. I might be able to stand here in 2009 and say that I'm grateful to God for creating me as a European. I don't know if my children, my grandchildren, will be able to say the same. The way that the discourse has changed in the past few years, it's eerily similar to how the discourse was in the 1920s about another religious group in Europe. And I'd like to ask for all of your reflections and your advice on how we, as people who believe in the essential doctrines of the common word, can actually think about how we don't just talk about the theological other and how to deal with that, but also the national other. Because I can very well imagine a world in which the common word becomes a dialogue between Muslims and Christians, and is very sustainable in that way, but Muslims out of Europe and Christians out of the Muslim world. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Hisham.
Good morning. My name is Jessica Sauer. I'm a graduate student in conflict resolution here at Georgetown University, and thank you all for coming. We're really happy to host you. My question has to do with evangelism. Islam and Christianity both have a history of evangelism. So how do we, as Christians and Muslims, commanded to bring others into our religion, balance evangelizing with acceptance of a pluralistic society?
Okay.
Hi, good morning, and thank you for coming. My name is Megan, and I'm also a student with the Conflict Resolution Program at Georgetown University. And my question has to do with theological exclusivity, which we talked about before. The question is, we've heard all morning about the need to be more pluralistic in society and to have more tolerance in society. What do you recommend that we do with violent extremists and their ideologies? Should we incorporate them and debate them and accept them in the name of tolerance? Or should we stand against them and say, this is not what our faith declares, and thus risk being able to call ourselves truly pluralist and truly accepting and tolerant of all religions and all religious interpretations? Thank you.
Thank you. So that's a trio of questions that we could actually have a conference about. Reflections on Europe and that kind of concept and the fears coming out of Europe, of given its history, and that focus on the national other. Looking at evangelism, both are evangelical faiths. How do we deal with that? And do we talk to extremists? Perhaps we could start with yourself, Bishop Younan, and then we'll move around.
Well, I think every question of these can have a lecture, you see. Yes, but, you know, I would like to do it, you know, very shortly. Maybe somebody else can speak about Europe. I am not a European.
Yeah, no problem.
So, I mean, you know, I cannot speak on behalf of others, you see, but you know. But the second point is about, you know, yesterday I mentioned, and I want to mention it again, even if we have the common word, which is a precious jewel for us, we have certain problems that we are to tackle among ourselves, Christians and Muslims. Some of them are, what does mission and evangelization, Christian mission and evangelization, mean in today's world? What does da'wah mean in today's world? Because both religions are very missionary oriented. We have really to study them in a deeper way, because, you know, if we will allow everybody to say, go and preach and convert, then we are really, making, especially Asia and Africa and some Latin America countries, a battlefield between Muslims and Christians. And we have to avoid that. For me, we have to discuss, what does freedom of religion mean? And what does the right of conversion of every individual mean? And once we clarify it, I think, you know, we are on a better way ahead. But once it is misty, we are really playing with words, we speak something and mean something else, it won't work. For me, this is a very important agenda for us. When we speak on a roadmap, this should be on our agenda and not shy to speak about it publicly. The second thing about extremists.
Can we, because I'm
okay,
gonna
I'll
never
stop
get
here.
This. I'll stop. Dr. Hunter, thank you so much.
Two quick points. First of all, I agree with the bishop. We need to have a common understanding about the difference between sharing your faith, which is personal, and which is a part of your life. And if you're going to know me, you're going to know Jesus. You can't be in a conversation for very long with me until I bring up one of two people: my wife, because she's my very best friend and she's the smartest person I know, and Jesus, because if you stick me, that's who's going to come out. That to know me is to know those two. Now, What is it? What are the aspects of respect that doesn't slip into a proselytization, a relationship for an ulterior motive? We need that understanding in order to be comfortable with one another. And the bishop's right, and the questioner was right. The two expansive religions in this world are Christianity, especially evangelical Christianity, and Islam. And so we've got to come up with that kind of understanding. The other thing, the other point that was made is, what do you do with the fundamentalists? You know, is pluralism? And I'm not sure we're recommending pluralism theologically. I think Dr. Mattson certainly said that. I think it's, you know, how you treat people. Is pluralism applied to religious fundamentalists? All of us have those in our faith communities. And I think, again, it is as a matter of respect. Each one has the right to say what they need, what they want to say. But I don't think that a lot of effort to include those who make their reputation and their money by attack is going to be very successful, and it could drain a lot of our efforts into a very non-productive conduct. So that's the way I'd answer those two.
Father Michel, I know you want to come in on this.
Christians and Muslims, we are both open communities. We don't shut the door on anybody who wants to join us. Secondly, we love our faiths. We are convinced that they're the greatest gift that God has given to us. So it's natural that we don't want to hide it from others. I think the critical thing is, how do we share our faith? How do we express our faith? And whenever I use the poverty or the ignorance of anyone else to try to encourage them to enter my religion, I think that's wrong, no matter what my religion is. That's all.
And Dr. Mattson, do you have any words for Europe, being a Muslim minority in the United States? Do you feel a minority here? What's your experience, and how can Europe learn from that?
Well, I was actually going to talk about evangelizing, but...
Well, we've had lots of evangelizing. Yeah. It's just nobody's answered Shannon's question.
But I think it's important because it comes up again and again in these things. The issue is one is the issue of power. And the whole idea of this idea or the theory of freedom of religion reminds me of, in our community, the issue of women's participation in our communities. You may have some who will say, oh yes, women are allowed, but there are all of these structural barriers to prevent them. I mean, if it's not prohibited from keeping women out of the mosque, is it okay to give them, you know, a really crappy, you know, entrance to the mosque in a small space that no one, so like deter them. So this is the thing with freedom of religion. It's not all right in theory to say, yeah, so everyone's free, and then set up these economic, political, social barriers so they cannot express that in any way. And that's why we have to analyze our own use of power. And I would say that this is whether it's the case of so-called religious minorities. There's a huge difference between being a Muslim in the United States than being a Muslim in Europe. Absolutely. And that has to do not just because Muslims in the United States are more educated or more diverse. All of those things are important. The fact that we have an indigenous Muslim community, the African American community, that showed us the way how to be American. But because of the nature of America itself, there is a place. What does it mean? I mean, Europe is named, most of the countries of Europe are named after a specific linguistic, ethnic group. You're French or German or Italian or Spanish. America is about the land. And so this is really the challenge to Europeans themselves. Who are they? And when they figure out who they are, then it'll be easier for Muslims to understand what it means to be a European Muslim.
Okay, now, I know I didn't miscount, but I think someone was hiding somewhere. So we actually have four, because I know that you were the last in the blue, blue shirt. So I'm going to take all four of you very, very quickly, and then I'm going to come to concluding points from the panel, literally very short, succinct, pithy concluding points. And then I actually would have done it, you know, all of this in an hour and a half. So go for it.
Yes, I'm Rabbi Jerry Serrata. I'm the co-founder of Clergy Beyond Borders with the Imam of Georgetown University, Imam Yahya Hendi, who's the Muslim chaplain here. Despite my teacher, Ingrid's comment, I'd like to direct a little bit towards the theological issues that you raised with the image of the walls in heaven. The real question I have succinctly is, does God require religious pluralism? Is it part of God's plan that there be religious pluralism? Can we somehow affirm the moral worth of each other, at least within the Abrahamic community? I love the image of Reverend Hunter that was sort of a theology of complementarity, that Jews need Christians and Muslims, that Muslims need Christians and Jews. That is at least an approach from which we could work towards an understanding that this is what God wants. It is beautifully wonderful that we can work together on ethical issues and social justice project, and certainly the relationship matters primarily in how we'll influence people, not by writing a theology, but I believe we can work towards a theology of pluralism if we work hard, if we work hard at it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Imtiaz Yusuf. I'm a visiting professor at Georgetown University. I come from Thailand, where I teach at a Catholic university. I teach interfaith dialogue at a Catholic university. Often I feel that I'm a Muslim among a Buddhist, and a Buddhist among a Muslim, or I'm a Muslim among a Catholic, or a Catholic among a Muslim, but I'm not a syncretist. So my question is this: where it is very easy to accept equality of human beings, why not equality of religions? Thank you.
Okay.
I'm Dudley Woodbury from Fuller Theological Seminary. It will be easy to be short because I've seen my question whittled away, and part of what I would see is the answer being whittled away as I've been walking up here. But again, the major challenge I feel for us is how we can be witnesses to our faith, because we have both Muslims and Christians have something we believe everybody needs to hear. For Christians, Muslims, and for Muslims, Christians. So how can we do this in a way that does not misuse power in our development programs and so forth, and that shows respect, that shows our openness to learn as well, and perhaps closing with the common word of love that is done in a way that shows love for God and love for neighbor rather than competition.
Okay, and our final audience contributor who stood for a long time. Thank you so much.
I'm Will Amatruda, Georgetown Law alumnus. It was good to hear that Arab Christians feel that they are completely equal, at least within the Kingdom of Jordan. But I think about the fact that George Antonius, who was one of the most articulate spokesmen for Palestinians in the 1930s, did not have the influence that he might have had precisely because he was a Christian. I think of the fact that the percentage of Christians in Bethlehem has been declining steadily. And of course, there's the civil war in Lebanon. How does one reconcile these two sets of facts?
Okay, thank you. That's directly for you, right. So, I mean, a couple of questions about religious pluralism, the quality of religions, how to be witnesses to our faith, and then the specific question about Arab Christians to Bishop Younan. I think we'll just start in the same order that we started with, so, and these make these your concluding comments as well.
Very brief comment. Does God intend, does God want there to be a plurality of religions? I just came last week. I was at a conference in Geneva, which is an initiative of the Saudi king, the custodian of the two holy mosques. And starting last year in Mecca, and then in Madrid, and then in Geneva this year, each time the declaration has stated that the plurality of religions, at least in the Abrahamic tradition, has been intended by God, which I found surprising, but I find it a consistent message that has come out of these meetings. For as a Christian, I don't believe that the church has pronounced on this. Now, is this a good thing or a bad thing? I think it's a good thing. It allows our theologians to continue to reflect on this, to keep on thinking about it, to keep on offering their opinions. I think that's as much as we can say as Christians. I myself believe personally that God has intended the plurality of religions. I believe at the same time that everyone who is saved by what God has done for us once and for all in the person of Jesus. This I believe as a Christian. How do I put these together? Well, I'm still thinking about it. I'm still reading, still reflecting, studying. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to speak first of all for the last question, and I have then a final remark. One, you know, I am the bishop also of Palestine. And, you know, Palestinians are under occupation. And occupation is not occupying Muslims, but not Christians. Both of us, Palestinian Christians and Muslims, are under occupation. And at the same time, I want to say very clearly that the Muslim-Christian relations also in Palestine are very good. Sometimes, like you have, we have social problems that we have to discuss, mixed marriages, other issues that exist. But the recent study which my church has done about Palestinian Christian immigration, we used to be 15% of the total population, we are now less than 2%. The reasons are three, according to this survey. And if you like, you know, I hope we are not out of print, but we can really. The first reason is the difficult measures that the occupation are giving to the Palestinians in general, checkposts, walls, and all these things. The second point is the lack of job opportunities. The third point is the growth of religious and political extremism in Palestine and Israel. These are the major reasons of immigration. And we also, as Palestinian Christians, we have our own impact in the society, and I don't want to make now a lecture. My last point is extremism. When we speak on I am evangelical Lutheran. When the evangelistic movements come to the Middle East, they don't take into consideration the local community, the local Christians, neither Jordanian Christians, nor Palestinian Christians, nor Arab Christians. They come there for their agenda. And their agenda is political, and their agenda is eschatological. So, I mean, for this reason, I always say, I think those evangelistic groups that are coming there are harming the local community more than they are helping them. This is the reason you have to understand that the support for the mainline churches that are serving in their witness for the society, either educational or hospitalization or social work, is very, because it is not only serving Christians, it's serving every human being, regardless of gender, ethnicity, political or religious affiliation. For me, evangelistic groups that are extremists from the United States are harming the local Christians, and we ask your help for that.
Thank you. Dr. Mattson.
I think the, I really think the solution to a lot of these problems is some honesty on the part of individuals. You know, I think what, this isn't the place to give my own personal understanding of theological pluralism, but let me just say that what I believe God wants from us is for us to be honest in our relationship with Him. And what I mean by that is that we act on what we know at the time to be true. Throughout my life, I've known different things, and I've had different understandings of the reality, of the divine reality. And what I've tried to do, and I'm not, you know, I'm not a very good person, so I haven't been successful, you know, in all of these stages, but what I've tried to do is to be honest about what I, at that time, know and believe. And that means, that honesty means that as life changes, as new experiences, knowledge, people come into my life, I'll grow and I'll change. And how I'll understand my religion, my relationship with God will change. Sometimes that will mean a change of community, a faith community, or a shift. But, you know, if we're not honest about that, if we pretend that somehow we've always been the same throughout our whole lives, and that not only that, but what we know about our faith is what everyone else believes and has always believed throughout history, as if there's this, you know, statically defined relationship that is religion, it's unreal. That's insincere. So I think, you know, and this is where love comes in. Loving other people means that we value their honest struggle and their sincerity. And I think if we teach that first humility in ourselves and in the people in our community who we're teaching and working with, then we won't have a lot of problems with rights and disrespect, because what we're going to love in people is the sincerity of their struggle at whatever stage they are and at whatever point they are in their life, that, you know, what God has revealed to them in their life at that point.
Okay, thank you. And Dr. Hunter.
Well, let me build on what Dr. Mattson said. It's very profound, as well as, you know, I could go, every one of these panelists, I'm going, yeah, I'm just, first of all, those of us who have been following God as He has been revealed to us for a long time understand how little we understand God. The mark of spiritual maturity is a realistic humility of how much you don't understand. The scripture has a saying, words, you know, that God is saying, my ways are higher than your ways. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. And so all we can do is follow the revelation that has been given to us. And retire our need for simple certainty that comes from a pride and a desire always to be right, which translates always into power. And understand how many ways that God shows up in our lives. Scripture has another saying, all things work to good for those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. And if you believe that, you can let a lot of things ride and develop as God will develop them. You can realize it's not your business to convert anyone, it's your business to serve. Simple service. Your business is share the most important things in your life and let God handle the rest. And so one of the reasons I'm so honored to be in a group like this is that every time someone opens their mouth, I hear more of God. I am closer to Him. And I learn how necessary that person is to my loving my neighbor better. So thanks for the privilege of being here.
Thank you so much. Jamaluddin Rumi said, the lamps are different, but the light is the same. That might be a little too inclusive for some, but I think what we've seen today is the sense that that everyone is at least searching for the light. We can see that there's a lot of discussion still to be had and a lot of practical works of service still to be done. Perhaps we can talk whilst working together. Please thank our contributors and thank you, the audience. It's been an absolute pleasure. Anything I've said of any use is from God. The mistakes, they're mine.